I am G.S. Nair, belonging to Kerala, from Trivandrum district. I was the faculty in Indian Institute of Handloom Technology. I was working in Salem as well as Jodhpur, Rajasthan. After my retirement in 2013, I was the consultant for government of Kerala for implementing a project called Handloom Business Incubator. I also 4 inventions to my credit. I have developed a sizing machine called a spool sizing machine. And I have developed another loom called a hand loom cart. Loom cart means the loom which can be used for sleeping also. On folding it, it will be a cart. On opening it, it will be a loom. And I also developed a loom called a nano hand loom, the most simplest hand loom, which can be moved within the house from place to place very easily. And its structure is very low, and comparatively price is also very low. I have also developed another machine called spool warping machine, which is used for warping folded yarns, which doesn't require sizing. So I am also on the job of developing, I am doing research on another work, that's research work, that is developing a design setup which can control every thread in the warp directly, and the loom can be operated, the design can be inserted through internet. So that is also, I am working under the Kerala government.
I am Hemendra, I come from Madhya Pradesh, and I'm working there for last 10 years in the weaving communities to promote handloom weaving. And I have my work last 10 years handloom, and before that working in various livelihood activities. So mostly my work is concentrated with the communities.
Thank you. Madam was asking me which invention is very favorite to me. Actually, it is as good as asking which son or daughter is favorite to a father or mother, because all children are equal to a father and mother. Anyhow, of all these 4 inventions, which child is studying well or something like that, some importance can be given to the machine called spool sizing machine. In the handloom sector, as far as my knowledge is concerned, as of today, there is no proper sizing machine. Whenever we need some sized yarn for a specific weaving, either we go for sheet sizing, or single yarn sizing, or hang sizing, or at last we are depending upon the mill sizing. When our requirement of fabric is a large quantum, then we go for mill sizing. But mill sizing is not actually the sizing which the handloom sector is supposed to adapt. Handloom sector is having some speciality. Its products are special in all of the universe. The handloom sector should maintain its quality and the product speciality. So a sizing was required for the sector. The government of Kerala requested me to develop a sizing machine. So I have developed a sizing machine, which I just told you, spool sizing machine. Now why this machine is called a spool sizing? The yarn after sizing is wound on spool, and the spool is loaded on the loom directly. So by this way of sizing, so many intermediate processes are eliminated. So much of time is saved for sizing yarn. As of today, one machine can size 240 ends maximum. So 240 ends is taken from the cream and passed through the size solution, that is soap box, and then is brushed. Just like the handloom brushing, in a sheet sizing we are doing the brushing process. Similar to that, the spool sizing machine is also having the brushing process. And after brushing, the yarn is dried and then wound on a spool. So what is the specialty of this machine, as I just now, as I was telling you, there is no, I mean, most of the extra process, warping process is not there, because the machine is meant for warping and sizing together. So no separate warping process. Drying, most of the process, I mean the sizing process we are adapting in handloom sector is dyed natural day or natural heat. So what happens in the night, we cannot dry, or in the early morning, we cannot do it. In the rainy season, absolutely it's not possible. So handloom weaving process is totally put into difficulty, particularly in rainy season. So these processes come into halt. So this is a mechanized process where the yarn is taken from the creel, passing through the size mixture, then squeezing, extra solution is squeezed, then brushing to get the effect of handloom sizing. That is a specialty of stitch sizing, what we do all over India. And afterwards, dried and wound on a spool directly go to the loom. And if suppose 240 ends are there in the spool, one spool, if you keep 10 spools in the mounted in the loom, 2400 ends comes together. So the sizing is simplified. There is no barrier of day and night or summer and rainy season. It's an in-house process, irrespective of the climate and things, you can do the sizing. The most important factor of the sizing, the advantage of the sizing is, it retains the cylindrical shape of the yarn. That's what we are doing, the normal hang sizing or stitch sizing or single yarn sizing. In all these three processes, we are not damaging or spoiling the size or structure of the yarn. In this machine, this is the only machine where the structure of the yarn is not damaged. So this retains the cylindrical shape of the yarn. And then you get a, just like a stitch sized yarn, you will get the output. That's the specialty of the machine. And this machine costs 5.5 lakhs and taxes, and is being manufactured at Coimbatore, Tamil Nadu.
Andariki namaskaramulu. Chennur village, Telangana, Adilabad district nundi vachina. Naa peru Odelu. Maa vritti cheneta andulo gata 28 samvatsaramula nundi prakruti rangula addakam chestu danto paatu weaving chestu ఇప్పుడు మేము 91లో స్టార్ట్ చేసి ఒక గ్రూప్గా వెలిసి ఆరుగురితోటి ఈరోజు ఒక 25 మందితో కలిసి పనిచేయడం జరుగుతుంది. అయితే ప్రకృతి రంగుల అద్దకం ఏదైతుందో దాని ద్వారా ఎంత మేము ప్రొడక్షన్ చేసినా అది అమ్మడం పోవడానికి ఎలాంటి సమస్య లేదు. ఈరోజు ఇక్కడ నేను చూసినటువంటి చేనేత కళాకారులను చూసినప్పుడు నాకు ఏమనిపిస్తుంది అంటే, దీనిని ఇక ముందు పోవడానికి మనసు ఎలాగైనా ఈ పని చేయాలనేది ఒక భావన కలిగేనట్టు విధంబలన అనిపిస్తుంది. ఎందుకంటే చేతి కళ నైపుణ్యము ఎలాంటిది అంటే, ఈరోజు ఎన్నో విధముల పరిశోధన చేసి హెచ్డీలు చేసి కూడా ఎప్పుడైనా చేతి కళ నుండి చేతి నుండి పూర్వీకుల నుండి తీసుకొని చేయడమే కానీ, ఎన్ని విధాల పరిశోధనలు చేసి పేపర్ మీద రాయడమే కానీ, పురాతనమున చేసినటువంటి పద్ధతిని తీసుకున్నప్పుడే మనము దానిని రెంటిని కూడా కలిసి చేసేదానికి అవకాశం ఉంటుంది. కాబట్టి అలాంటి పద్ధతులు మనము ఇంకా మునుముందు తీసుకుపోవడానికి ఉజ్రమ్మ వంటి వాళ్ళు చాలా ముందుకు వచ్చి ఉంటే మనము ఇంకా ఎన్నో పరిశోధనలు చేస్తూ ముందుకు పోగలుగుతాము. నా పేరు ఓదెలు చెన్ను.
నా పేరు మాచర్ల సాంబశివరావు, హస్తినాపురం, చీరాల మండలం, ప్రకాశం జిల్లా, ఆంధ్రప్రదేశ్. నా వృత్తి చేనేత వృత్తి. గత 10 సంవత్సరములు మైక్రో స్పిన్నింగ్ యూనిట్లో మన అక్కాయపాలెం వద్ద ఒక యూనిట్ ఉన్నది. ఆ యూనిట్లో నేను 10 సంవత్సరాలు స్పిన్నింగ్ వర్కర్గా పనిచేశాను. తదుపరి ఖమ్మం జిల్లాలో ఉన్నటువంటి పునుకుల గ్రామంలో చేనేత మగ్గాలు రైతులకు మగ్గం ఎలా నేయాలో నేర్పించాను.
నా పేరు మాతల శివశ్రవంతి, అసనాపురము, జాండ్రబేడ. నేను 12 సంవత్సరాల నుంచి చిన్న వయసులోనే చేనేత కార్మికురాలిగా ఉండిపోయాను. ఈ రోజున మాస్టర్ వీవర్స్ చేనేత కార్మికులు చేస్తున్న విధానంలో రాష్ట్ర చేనేత జన సమాఖ్య వారి ఆధ్వర్యంలో చేనేత కార్మికులకి ఇటువంటి రాష్ట్ర చేనేత జన సమాఖ్య చేయదలుచుకున్న పథకాలు, వాళ్ళ భవిష్యత్తు, వాళ్ళ విధానాల్లో మేము అందుట్లో చేనేత కార్మికులకి సహాయం చేస్తూ ఉన్నాను ఈ రోజున.
థ్యాంక్ యూ వెరీ మచ్ శ్రవంతి. హ్యాండ్లూమ్ వీవర్ సర్టన్లీ ఇన్ దిస్ పార్ట్ ఆఫ్ ద వరల్డ్, ఐఎమ్ నాట్ టాకింగ్ అబౌట్ ద నార్త్ ఈస్ట్ పార్ట్ వేర్ ద వీవింగ్ ఇస్ వెరీ డిఫరెంట్. ఇన్ most of India, where people weave either on the pit loom or on the frame loom, suddenly when they weave on the pit loom, the weaver faces the warp, and in front of him or her is a television set. Anakada Shravanti, when you are weaving, there is mundu oka television untundi, so they are watching television as they weave. While they're watching television, they're weaving. Now, these two are very different worlds. The world which the weaver sees on television is very different from the world where the weaver, who is actually sitting on the loom, on his from his daily reality. He is sitting at the loom, she or he sitting at the loom, making this cloth, and yet what they see on television is a totally different world. They see the advertisements which, you know, feature very glamorous looking women, and they see the soap operas where all these very rich people. None of these people, women or men, in the television ads or in the soap operas, none of them is wearing handloom cloth. Ana kada opkuntara ante meer television understand. Do you understand? So how, so then what is the young weaver, how is she or he supposed to make sense of this world where there are two very different parts, and the young weaver has to be part of this world as well as think about the world outside his world. So I'm going to ask Mr. Nair, what is the future for handloom weaving today? And I want you to say it in short, because we will all talk about it and then we will come back to the original panelists. Mr. Nair, what is your opinion about the future of handloom weaving in India?
Very difficult question, which I can answer as of today, because on one side, the technological developments taking place in all walks of life is so fast, and the money requirement for normal living for every citizen is increasing day by day. Now, what is the, when you want to tell about the future of handloom, then we need to analyze what is handloom's position today. That's very important. The as our culture, Indian culture, varying from Kashmir to Kanyakumari, lot of culture variation. The handloom products also is varying. The product what we are making in Nagarkoil, very close to Kanyakumari, is much of difference that of the product we are making in Kashmir or Srinagar. And the people who are working in Nagarkoil also work for survival. They want to exist, they want to live. And the people working in Srinagar also want to exist. What the product they are making in say Nagarkoil is different. Maybe in between some products can fetch the market, fetch the wages required for the for a weaver to survive in a day. But there are products what we are having in the country. Our weavers are weaving certain products which cannot fetch the minimum requirement of a weaver. So this variation is there, and main problem with our weaver is most cases, in most of the cases, our weavers from the villages, they show least interest in changing their products and updating their products. Now, some of you may be knowing what is the milk sector going on, how it is growing. The latest weaving machine, which is developed and yet to come to the market, can produce 5,000 meters of fabric per day. In a day, it can produce 5,000 meters. And that is the situation. Ordinary airjet loom, a rapier loom, a projectile loom can manufacture something like 250 to 300, 400 meters of fabric in a shift of 8 hours. And we are competing with them. Our Handloom, poor Handloom weaver, sitting in front of the loom, sitting in the loom from the morning to overnight, may be in a position to produce 4 to 8 or 10 meters depending upon the product. And where he can compete with that people who are producing this mass quantum of fabrics, then what is the way out? According to me, our way out is to switch out to the products which the people cannot, the mill people or the latest mill industry cannot produce. So in a way, what I am suggesting, I am telling in every meeting, that Handloom weaver should switch over to the product, just like a handicraft item, which cannot be copied, which cannot be produced by the mill sector, which cannot be produced by the mill sector. Of course, once upon a time, long back, the Handloom sector were proud of talking about Kanjivaram sari, and that cannot be produced in power loom. But about 99% of the ditto of Kanjivaram sari is produced in power loom. So when we go ahead with us, two steps ahead, our Handloom power loom sector is following us, and whatever we are producing, Handloom sector we are producing and selling at a very competitive price, and a reasonable price, and fetching reasonable wages to the weaver, the power loom sector is coming there. That's the problem. I hope my suggestion is that Handloom people should use the technology and should use the produce the product which cannot be captured by the power loom sector.
So before I go on to Hemender Sharma as our next panelist, I would ask Mr. Nair to respond to the fact that today in India we have over 4 million looms. Some people say it's 4.3 million. Some people say it's 4.5 million. But everybody agrees that today there are over 4 million hand looms in India. Now, if, as you suggest, they produce the very speciality fabrics only, how many weavers would we need to make those speciality products?
Actually, the per capita consumption of cloth, sometime back, we were finding difficult to purchase the cloth for our. If I remember my schooling days, I was having one half fryer and one shirt for the whole of session, I have to say either. But today it is not that situation. Even a poor family, they are having at least a set of dresses. That means per capita consumption of the cloth is increasing. So, you see the saris, a middle class people, middle class woman is keeping at least more than 2 dozen saris in his wardrobe. So that's not the old age. Now the purchasing capacity of the people, country is developing, growing. The purchasing capacity of the people is developing, increasing. So even if the entire weaver of the country produce the costly item, which cannot be copied by the other foreign sector, I am sure this can be marketed. That's my...
So, but what are the products that can't be? Because everything is being copied.
No, see, what is a certain items like piece goods, color pieces, or a certain dhoti items, not all dhoti items, certain dhoti items, very cheap, with no design value sarees. This we should leave it. We should
only
have...
The cheap items.
Only yes,
the cheap.
These items we should do. Still, in some areas, our viewers are producing genoa sarees.
Yeah, but how much do they earn for that? Will there be enough? Can they earn enough money weaving the cheapest dhotis?
No, they should not be, why I am telling you, madam. The handloom weaver should not go for genoa saree.
Yes.
I am telling they should go for expensive sarees.
So which are the products which Powerloom cannot reproduce?
Certain designs of Kanjipuram saree, or even sarees of our Ilkal sarees, or even Andhra Pradesh Gadwal sarees, where you have cotton and silk combinations. Like there are humpty number of varieties in the country, the weaver should go.
Right. Thank you very much, Mr. Nair, for your opinion. Now, Mr. Nair suggested that handloom weavers should weave only the products which are very expensive and which cannot be copied on the power loom. Do you agree?
Chaineta Vastramulo Takkava Daralo Tayaru Cheste Marketing Bagane Untundi Kani Nulu Patti Daralu Vipreetanga Periginandavalla Vatikese Rangulu Rasayanalu Kuda Daralu Periginandavalla Chaineta Karmikudu Takkava Daraki Battanu Tayaru Chesi విక్రయించే పరిస్థితిలో లేడు. కాబట్టి పేద వర్గానికి అమ్ముడు పోవాలంటే చేనేత బట్ట తక్కువ ధరలో విక్రయించగలిగే పరిస్థితి మనకి ప్రభుత్వాలు కానీ పాలక వర్గాలు కానీ మనకున్న వసతుల్లో కానీ లభ్యమైతే చేనేత వృత్తి అభివృద్ధి చెందుతుందని నా అభిప్రాయం. చేనేత రంగంలో చేనేత మగ్గం మీద తయారైనటువంటి బట్ట కాస్ట్లీగానే ఉంటుంది. ఎందుకంటే కుటుంబ సభ్యులు అందరూ కూడా కలిసి మగ్గం మీద పనిచేస్తేనే ఆ బట్ట తయారవుతుంది. వాళ్ళకి వేతన గిట్టుబాటు కానివ్వండి, నూలు రంగులు రసాయనాల ధరలు కానివ్వండి అధికంగా ఉంటాయి, వాళ్ళకి రోజువారీ వేతనమే చాలా తక్కువగా గిట్టుబాటు అవుతుంది. అదే ఈ పౌర్లం మగ్గం వారికి అయితే ఒక వ్యక్తి 4-5 మౌరు మగ్గాలని చూసుకోగల సామర్థ్యం ఉంటుంది, పైపెచ్చు పౌరుతోటి పనిచేస్తారు. కాబట్టి పౌరులంలో తయారైనటువంటి వస్త్రము మన్నిక తక్కువ ఉంటుంది, ధర తక్కువగా ఉంటుంది. చేనేత మీద తయారైన బట్ట మగ్గం మీద మన్నిక ఎక్కువగా ఉంటుంది, ధర ఎక్కువగానే ఉంటుంది.
So basically, Sambasiva Rao Garu is adding to what Mr. Nair has said, that all the costs of making handloom have increased, like the cost of the chemical dyes and the cost of the raw material, the yarn, everything has increased. And so the weaver is therefore earning less. And basically, he seems to agree with what Mr. Nair is saying, is that the handlooms are having a more difficult time carrying on in the way they are. And I don't know, he doesn't seem to have addressed the issue of perhaps only weaving the expensive stuff which the handlooms cannot weave. But Shravanti Noedu Chitta. So we will hear now from a young weaver, Shravanti.
చేనేత కార్మికులు పవర్లోంకి చేనేత మగ్గానికి పవర్లోంకి ఉన్న తేడా, చేనేత కార్మికుడు బట్ట తయారు చేయాలంటే 14 రకాల నుంచి కష్టపడి తయారు చేస్తేనే ఒక బట్ట తయారవుతుంది. అలాగే పవర్లోంలో వచ్చేటప్పటికి ఒక మిషన్ మీద ఇవన్నీ రావు. ఒకసారి అందరూ అర్థం చేసుకోండి, ఎందుకంటే ఒకసారి మీరు కూడా ఎడ్యుకేషన్ చేసుకోవచ్చు. ఎందుకంటే ఈ చేనేత కార్మికుడు పగలనక రాత్రనక ఎంత కష్టపడి ఒక బట్ట తయారు చేస్తే పౌర్లం వాళ్ళు దాన్ని కాఫీ చేసి చేనేత కార్మికుడిని దెబ్బతీస్తున్నారు. చేనేత కార్మికుడు ప్రతి ఒక్క దానికి సంబంధించి రాట్నం కానీ నూలు కానీ ఆసు కానీ ఇవన్నీ మీరు చూస్తే దీనికి పౌర్లంకు తేడా ఏంది అనేది మీరే చెప్పగలరు. అటువంటిప్పుడు పౌర్లంని మన చేనేత కార్మికులు ఎందుకు వ్యతిరేకిస్తున్నారనేది, పౌర్లంని ఎందుకు వద్దంటున్నారనేది కూడా మీరు అందరూ గుర్తించండి. చేనేత కార్మికులు ఈ రోజు వరకు కూడా 4,000కి 3,000 కష్టపడుతున్నారే కానీ 1,000కి ఎప్పుడు కష్టపడతలేదు. చేనేత కార్మికుడే నేను చేనేత పట్టం తయారు చేస్తాడా కానీ పౌర్లం మిషన్స్ పవర్స్ కాదు. ఇప్పుడు చేనేత కార్మికులకు కూడా మగ్గాల మీదకి మిషన్ తేవాలని ట్రై చేస్తున్నారు ప్రభుత్వం వాళ్ళు. దాన్ని మేము వ్యతిరేకిస్తున్నాము. దయచేసి మీరు అందరూ గమనించండి.
హలో, చేనేత కార్మికులు ఈరోజు ఏదైతే వేతనాలు తక్కువ పడుతుంది అనే అటువంటి సమస్య ఇప్పటిదాకా మనం మాట్లాడుకున్నాము. కానీ ముఖ్యంగా ఎవరైతే చేనేత కార్మికులు ఉన్నారో వాళ్ళ దగ్గర ఉండే అటువంటి యొక్క పదునైన ఆయుధాన్ని ఒకరి చేతికి ఇవ్వడం జరిగింది. అప్పుడు దాన్ని ఇవ్వడం వరకు మన వంతుండే, కానీ తీసుకోవడం మనతో కావడం లేదు. ఎందుకంటే పూర్వంలో ఆ విలువైన చేనేత పని, చేతి పని చేనేత పని వారి చేతిలోనే ఉండేది. కానీ ఒక విధంగా యంత్రాలు తీసుకొచ్చి యంత్రాలు అమర్చినప్పటికీ వారు పనిచేయనటువంటి సందర్భం ఉండదని, అందులో ఎవరైతే చేనేత పని చేసేవారు ఉన్నారో వాళ్ళ దగ్గర ఉండే అమూల్యమైనటువంటి పని దానికి అనుసంధానం చేసుకొని మనలా ఒకరిద్దరిని కానీ కొంతమందిని వాళ్ళు వినియోగించుకొని ఈరోజు చేనేత పని వారి మీద దెబ్బ పెట్టినటువంటి సమస్య జరిగిపోయింది. అందువలన మనము చేనేత పని చేసే వాళ్ళము చాలా ఎప్పటి నుండో చాలా రోజుల నుండి కూడా మనము దిగజారిపోవడానికి కారణము అది మన చేతి నుండి మన చేదార చేసుకున్నటువంటి సందర్భం ఉన్నదని నేను అనుకుంటున్నాను. దానికి ఏదైనా సమాధానం ఉంటే మీరు.
సో ద క్వశ్చన్ రిమైన్స్, ఇస్ దర్ అ ఫ్యూచర్ ఫర్ హ్యాండ్లూమ్ వీవింగ్? మిస్టర్ నాయర్ సేస్ దట్ దర్ ఇస్ ఓన్లీ అ ఫ్యూచర్ ఇఫ్ దే మేక్ అ సర్టన్ నంబర్ ఆఫ్ ఐటమ్స్ which the Powerloom cannot make, and the other three people on the thing who have spoken up to now, Hemendra has not yet spoken, they are just talking about the problems which handloom weaving is facing today in the competition from Powerloom and also the increased prices of the raw materials. So I would like to ask first the panelists, and then we will hear from Hemendra also. Is there a future at all for handloom weaving in India? So no, nu em anta ante bhavishyatti lo evarana untara ee vruthi lo. So Samasiva Rao says that yes, there will always be a handloom weaving industry, and Shravanti says very firmly that there will definitely be a handloom weaving industry. Odalu ni abhiprayam enti? Ni abhiprayam enti deentlo adi ee vruthi untunda ledha bhavishyattilo?
Eppudu cheneta anedi eppudu kuda adi daniki oka vidhamaina jeevam unnadi. Endukante ఏ రోజైనా కానీ పరిశ్రమలు మిల్లు లాంటి ఏ రోజైనా పోవచ్చు, కానీ చేతికాలు అనేది మాత్రం జీవంతోనే ఉంటుంది. ఎందుకంటే అధికంగా పనిచేయకపోయినప్పటికీ కూడా చేతికాలు అనేది చేనేత పనివారు ఎప్పుడు కూడా పూర్తిగా సజీవంగా జీవంగానే ఉంటుంది, ఖచ్చితంగా ఉండి తీరుతుంది ఎన్ని రోజులకైనా.
వాట్ ఇస్ యువర్ ఒపీనియన్ మిస్టర్ నాయర్?
హ్యాండ్లూమ్ వీవింగ్ విల్ డెఫినెట్లీ సర్వైవ్, ఇట్ విల్ కంటిన్యూ.
So we have left Hemendra mostly out of this discussion. Now I would like to ask Hemendra what has been his experience. He has been associated with handloom weavers for many years. And how, Heminder, what is your relationship to handloom weaving? And in your opinion, what do we need to do for the handloom weaving to survive? And how have the people who are running the handloom school or what you are doing there, how does that help handloom weaving to survive?
So my association with handloom is basically I see handloom as it is second largest source for livelihood in rural India. So my main concern is livelihood, and I see that there is a great potential in rural India. If handloom will survive, then more people will get employment. In my last 10 years work, means I contributed to revive handloom weaving in the places which were unknown, even not in the census of government of India that the weaving exists. So for example, the place called Dindori in eastern Madhya Pradesh or Satna in eastern Madhya Pradesh, two weaving clusters which have completely lost the weaving tradition, Bara Sivni and Sonsa, which is near Nagpur. And also worked in Maheshwar, which is more prosperous handloom weaving cluster. So in my last 10 years journey in handloom sector, I only witnessed the growth and prosperity in handloom. For handloom sector in large, like in this part of India where like this only village has more than 10,000 weavers, and there are many other areas which have more number of weavers. See, there are gaps which need to be fulfilled, and there are possibilities which are developing. Because of that, you can say there is a brighter future for handloom weaving. So one example for like the question which is asked initially, that the younger generation are watching television and weaving. So they are watching television and they are getting something out of that, which means like it is something like they are visualizing that, oh, if they could also have that kind of life, they have motorcycle, or they have a nice house, or they have air condition and all that. So that is something they get some aspiration for life from television. But on the other hand, which may be illusionary, like they may feel that why should I'm weaving on handloom, but actually when they by their own, or if someone help them to realize that what other they have as a resource, as a skill. So they may not have capital in their family to start any new business apart from handloom weaving. Second, they may not have agriculture land where they can work. So third is the only thing which is most important, is their weaving skill, which is not very fascinating for them because they are watching television and they are just sitting and think what I am doing. But one need to make them realize that you are making something which is one of the main industry for the civilization, the cloth. Cloth after food, like we all say na, roti, kapda and makan. So kapda is like one main industry which is survive till now and will survive until the civilization will survive. Now the important fact is like which one. There is a competition with another sector, power loom or mill, who are making the cloth also, and handloom also making the cloth. So I see the great value in younger generation, because earlier the master, see, weavers, they are always weaving. Basically the trading activities are done by the master weavers in their area. Now the master weavers and their sons, if you meet their sons, traditional master weavers and their sons are not very happy or interested continuing that handloom business. So but and the traditional master weaver, they are connected with the older market, like the traders who are in the cities who are buying traditionally from them and selling saris from their shop. The new phenomena is there are new market, there are new buyer, and those buyer need a different kind of dialogue which is more interactive. So the son of master weaver, he's not interested in that business, but the sons of weaver who watch TV, who has that aspiration of achieving something, if we help them to have some skills, for example when I tried to Google the weaving in Chirala, I hardly found interesting information. But when someone write about Maheshwar, you will find a lot, because everyone is writing, all the weavers are writing. So that is the difference. Now there is a new market, and that's global market, not only the Indian market, there is a global market, and one need information to the reach to the production centers, and that information is not there. So what I have contributed initially when in 2009 when I started working in handloom sector in Maheshwar, so I was working in an organization called Women Weave, and the founder of that organization asked that can you do something with the younger generation also apart from managing the other things in the organization. So there were 6 kids who came to us from the traditional weaving family, and they said they are interested to learn computer and English because that is fancy. They want to learn that. And they clearly said they don't want to continue with the handloom weaving. Now, this is almost 10 years old story. Those kids are now 24 or 25 years old. All of them are in handloom. One of the kid did his graduation in textile from NIFT Gandhinagar, and rest of them are in business. One is running 15 looms, one is running 20 looms. So how all that being changed? Changed because we were talking to them every time about English, maybe about computer, maybe about how to run business, how to run Facebook or social media and all that. They realize that there is a certain kind of people who are interested to buy textile because either they want unique product or they want something which is customized, or they are environment conscious, or so they want to save the planet. So that kind of people in India and abroad, that is rapidly growing. Like I interacted with more than 20 clients from more than 25 countries, and big brands, people who just fed up with the corporate job in New York City and said, oh, I want to do something meaningful and I want to source textile from India. And see, textile is something which is the main expression of human being. So everyone wants something new, different and all. So there is a potential. So you need to create people who can do that. And the younger generation is something which can do, and they know that if they are going to do, their interaction level is going to be high because they are interacting with the urban folk and all that. So in I think there is a great future in handloom.
The thing is, I think we work for almost 13 to 14 years with a lot of handloom weavers across the country. And what we realized is, I think most of the handloom weavers are not really happy with what they're doing. That's what I personally felt. So even if we try to do a lot with them, they always talk about their sons, their next generation who is not interested in handloom weaving. That got us to a different approach, where we thought there are many people who just sit idle in their, where they look for work but they don't get work. So what we try to do is one small experiment in India. We focused on women who which one? Yes. Who just sit idle in their home and they don't get to go out also. And what we try to do is we started working with them to get to them a little difficult for us. But once we got to them and once we started working with them, I'm talking about women who never got out of their house also. They could do something very interesting. In Bihar, especially in Siwan district, there were 19 villages where we targeted around 200 to 250 women, where we started teaching them spinning. We started with spinning. Slowly, Durga Prasad, got few women in teaching them stitching, and slowly we got few younger lot teaching them weaving. And I think in a year time, we could establish the whole link in such a way that I think it's going fine. And they really, the best part of this new set of people is they love what they're doing. They're pride, they take pride in what they're doing, and they get excited. That's a beautiful thing what I find with new people than working with viewers. And we are actually doing a different kind of experiment in Srikakulam, which we just started doing it, and we are more excited about our work, what we are going to do further. It's like that.
So how much were they earning before? They were not earning anything because they were sitting at home. So
I think this is the main idea behind it, where so when you go to any artisan, I think craft is beyond money. That's what I feel. Basically, you should love. When you love work, there is always you try to excel in what you're doing. So I think when you actually think of a product, there is nothing called excellence. Like you make it, you want it in 1,000 pieces, you want it in 2,000 pieces. You make the best machine also can do it. If you try to compete with a machine, there is no point. That's what I personally feel. I always feel man is far superior than the machine, and he or she has a lot of potential compared to the machine. So that potential need to be tackled. And I'm not trying to show it as a big thing, but it can happen, and I think maybe in 1 year we'll be able to do it.
So this is a completely different approach to hand weaving. Hand weaving as something that you love doing. And I think I agree with Satish I've been talking to the young weavers. This is, of course, Chirala is a place of weavers. So some young weavers have been passing by and they stopped to talk to us. And sure enough, they said what we all know, that the next generation doesn't want to weave. So they're saying that my father used to weave, but I don't want to weave. I'm going for ECE, which is electronics. What is ECE? Some electronics and something. Yeah, but then I asked them that, don't you know that there are things happening in the field of electronics which are reducing people's jobs? It's not that, you know, there's a ready-made job. So after you finish this course, what do you plan to do? So he says, they say we'll wait and see, and they know very well. They know everything that I was trying to tell them. They already know it. They said there are 20 lakh people who are graduating from ECE courses in India. And they know that you have to get into very advanced kind of electronics, like, artificial intelligence and so on. And they also know that that is not available to them. That is being taught only at the very high-end institutes of like IIT and so on. And so they know very well that they are not going to be able to get a job so easily with their education. But at the same time, at the same breath, they're saying, but we don't want to weave. So I'm not able to understand how these two things go together.
Netarangamlo jeevinche prati okkaru kuda naaku telisi nenu maa namma garu chanipoyindaaka naaku maggun cheta kaadu chanipoyin tarvata చదువుకు స్వస్తి చెప్పి కుటుంబ భారాన్ని మోస్తూ మగ్గం మీద జీవిస్తూ నా కుటుంబాన్ని పోషించుకుంటూ వచ్చి నాకంటే ముందు ఒక ఆయన ఉన్నాడు. అతన్ని చదివించడానికి దోహదపడింది. అలానే మగ్గం మీదనే నేను మా బాబుని కూడా చదివించుకున్నాను. మగ్గం మీద ప్రతి ఒక్కరూ కూడా ఈ చేతి పని చేనేత మగ్గం నేస్తూ తన బిడ్డల్ని
చదివించుకున్నారు, ఉద్యోగస్తులను చేసుకున్నారు, అందువలన కొద్దిగా దూరం అవుతున్నారే తప్ప చేనేత రంగాన్ని విడిచిపెట్టిపోయి జీవించాలనే ఆశ మనకి చేనేత కార్మిక రంగానికి కానీ చేనేత కార్మికులకు కానీ ఉండదు. వాళ్ళు ఎక్కడ ఉద్యోగాలు చేస్తున్నా సెలవుల్లో ఇంటికి వచ్చిన ఆ మగ్గం పని మీద పనిచేస్తూ తర్వాత సెలవులు అయిన తర్వాత మళ్ళీ ఇంటికి వెళ్ళి వాళ్ళ డ్యూటీకి వాళ్ళు వెళ్ళే పరిస్థితి ఉంది. కానీ చేనేత రంగాన్ని ఏనాడు విస్మరించే పరిస్థితి లేదని ఈ సభాముఖంగా
తెలియజేస్తున్నాం. I think there are four or five in around like 100 weavers, there are four or five who really enjoy the process of weaving. They try to explore new things, they try to, but other 95 to 96% what they do this act as it's pure labor, it's mostly it's like labor. So I think it's there is a difference, lot of difference between labor and skill. Weaver can be if you, there is a very fine line between skill and labor. If one can play around these two, there is always the chance of enjoying what you are doing. I think that's where we miss out. And technology, like what Mr. Nair was telling, like how technology plays important role. Technology should play important role to cut down drudgery, not to cut down skill. Because that's where I think all the policy makers, even if you see all the government schemes and all, I face a lot of problem with those. Like Narega, it says like it pays 200-300 rupees, they have other way to pay it, and it has cut down, it has dragged a lot of skilled people into that work. We are getting skilled people into labor, and there are hundreds of examples which I can say which is happening around, and there are a lot of skill development workshops that are happening. They have nothing to do with skill. So I think that's something I think one need to understand the difference between these two to get to a to see that. So I'm somebody who did textile design, and I have opted into handlooms because I have a lot of hope on handlooms. It's not like and I see maybe we even if the weavers cut down to very less numbers, after 5 years or it's going to be a great time for handloom weaving. That's what I feel.
బంగారం లాంటిది, ఎందుకంటే అది చిన్న గుర్జా వెత్తున్నప్పటికీ కూడా ఇది ఎప్పుడూ బంగారం బంగారం లాగానే ఉంటుంది. ఎన్ని పరికరాలతోటి ఎన్ని మిషన్లతో తయారు చేసినప్పటికీ దీనికి ఎప్పుడు కూడా సరిపోలు. ఎందుకంటే అగ్గిలో వేసిన మట్టిలో వేసిన ఎక్కడ వేసినా కానీ దాని యొక్క తేజస్సు అనేది ఎప్పుడు కూడా కరిగిపోదు, తరిగిపోదు, దాని తేజస్సు పోదు. అదేవిధంగా చేనేత కూడా ఎక్కడ ఉన్నా ఒక వీసము వెత్తు ఒక పైసా మందం ఉన్నప్పటికీ కూడా అది అలాగే తేజస్సుతో ఉంటుంది అనేది నేను అందరి ముఖంగా చెప్పుకుంటున్నాను. ఈ చేనేత విషయంలో నేను గర్వంగా ఎవరైనా పనిచేయాలని కూడా గర్వపడుతూ చెప్తున్నాను.
Can you just briefly translate that for the English to get?
No, very bad. I am very bad. Okay. So somebody else
so
has to do it. I don't want
I'm worse, but I will try. He's Odalu is saying that handloom weaving is like gold. You can change the way it is, but it remains gold. That was one of the metaphors which he used. And so, according to him, handloom weaving will always be there. But I want to ask Odalu a question. And Niko ka prashna adugutanu. According to what Satish says, meer edo pani chesthe, if you do any work, మీకు దాంట్లో సంతోషం సంతోషంగా సంతోషం తృప్తి వస్తుందా లేదా?
అంటే ఇది నేను చేనేత అనేది మా వృత్తిపరంగా వస్తుంది, అయినా వృత్తిపరంగా రాకపోయినప్పటికీ కూడా ఇది ప్రతి ఒక్క జీవనాడికి ఆధారమైనటువంటి ఒక పని. ప్రపంచంలో రెండవ స్థానం కలిగినటువంటిది చేనేత పరిశ్రమ. చేనేత పరిశ్రమ అని అంటున్నారే కానీ పౌర్లోమ్ పరిశ్రమ లేదు ఎక్కడ కూడా నేను వినలేదు. కాబట్టి చేనేత నుండి మాత్రమే పవర్లోముకి వెళ్ళింది, కానీ పవర్లోము నుండి చేనేతకు ఎప్పుడూ రాలేదు. కాబట్టి చేనేత అనే దాని మీద నాకు ఎంతో విలువగా నేను దాన్ని చూస్తూ అదే పనిలో చేస్తూ ఇక ముందు నేను కొంతమంది కూడా ఏరియాలో పిల్లలకు కూడా నేర్పించేసి వాళ్ళతో కొంతమందితో పని చేపిస్తూ ఇలా చేనేతను ముందుకు నడిపించాలనే భావనతో కూడా నేను ఉన్నాను.
Please.
basically what he is saying is like he has a lot of respect for handlooms and he is there for handlooms and he is ready to teach a lot of next generation young guys weaving, and he want to make sure that this continues, his journey continues, and he takes pride in what he does, and he really enjoy what he either dyeing and or weaving, whatever he does in handlooms.
He also said, as far as I could understand, that a country is famous for hand weaving. He never said that. He said that I never heard any country was famous for palm weaving.
The first thing that comes to my mind is what I'd like to take forward from Atish, that it all boils down to dignity of labor and dignity of craft that we are practicing today. And when we are comparing two different industries, be it Pavaloom versus Handloom, well, I have never come across any weaver or craftsperson who's been working in the Pavaloom or mill sector saying that they enjoy working in that sector. I have come across many weavers, yes, it's true, younger weavers who are getting initiated in handloom, like Satish said, and even older weavers, especially their grandfathers, who take the pride in remembering and of the memories that they hold dear to them when they were practicing handlooms and the way they passed on. Few very, very interesting examples that I've come across in Orissa that, you know, I think I feel very lucky working in Orissa. There is the northeast part of Orissa, that's the Jajpur district, where tassar weaving is practiced. It's a very strong decentralized system where from collecting cocoons to thigh reeling and producing khadi tassar silk yarn all the way to hand weaving is practiced in a decentralized local district. And you will not believe that in the past 10 years, more than 200 weavers have come back from Surat and joined handloom again.
From
Pavaloom sector back to handloom sector. So I think there is this very, very wrong myth that we have that big industries and Pavalooms and mills are what are offering promising livelihoods. No, that is not true. I think the government and the industries are not showing us a very honest picture. And the second point is definitely, I mean, I know, and when I spoke to those weavers who made a comeback from Pavaloom to back to their handloom, it is astonishing to hear their horror stories. The kind of exploitation that they faced in Surat, the living conditions were so poor, most of them would have they would catch very serious diseases like tuberculosis because of, you know, poor sanitation and water and living conditions. The work ethics were very, very poor from the top-down management. There weren't any breaks that they were given. Some of them were working for two to three complete shifts. That means up to 12 to 18 hours in a day without a break. They weren't given compensation for their overtime. And I mean, I can go on forever. So I think, yes, dignity of labor is one that we have to look into. Where, why is it that, how can we work around this idea where the weaver starts taking pride in his handloom? I work with one of the weavers, Babuli, who made a similar comeback from Pavaloom. He was very dejected. And all his friends, you know, so he had only studied till 10th grade, but most of his friends, you know, had finished up to engineering, but they all were struggling for jobs. He went to Surat, Tamil Nadu, Bangalore, worked in embroidery machines, Pavaloom sector, didn't do well, got ill and all of that, came back, couldn't save any money because the living standards are also more expensive in big cities. dejected, he forced himself to join Handloom with his father. Next year, he went on to win the state award on the first sari that he wore with us. And I think there was no going back then. So I think we have to be very, very careful in instilling pride and that dignity of what we do. And craft definitely offers that.
It is still a very important psychological part of a civilization. Not just of individuals, but of entire communities. And eventually of the civilization. Is how much sense of self-worth it has. And as Gunjan was saying, I have also not met any power loom worker who says with great pride that I work in power looms. Because the minute anybody has gone to work in power looms, they can see the inside story of the exploitation and the kind of living conditions. Nobody can be proud of working in a situation like that or of seeing themselves as being that kind of worker. So I think this is something that we need to think more about. We tend to think too much about the economic and financial aspects. They are definitely important, and nobody is saying, as I said just now, that people should just practice craft for the pleasure and not worry about daily bread. Of course, that also comes into it. But just to flip that saying the other way is to say there's also no satisfaction. Now, actually, we are seeing a lot of people coming out of IT who have been working for IT. They are, of course, of a different sort of social class, so they come back into organic farming or something to do with either the earth or crafts, which gives them much more satisfaction. There is somebody here who is part of the Nalsa group who has left financial career in finance and is now working in law. So this is something which I think we need to pay more attention to, is to have something to earn one's living in a way that enhances one's sense of self-worth and one's dignity.